Amen. Thank God. Thanks to God. Amen. For your liberal giving. Thank God for your liberal giving. Amen. Amen. Come on, give yourself a hand clap. Amen. Give yourself a hand clap. Amen. I mean, I believe that God gonna bless them in their giving. Amen. I believe that. I believe that with all my heart. Amen. We're gonna call Sister Linda up. She's gonna do our announcement for us. Amen.
Amen. Giving honor to the Spirit of Christ, to my bishop in his absence, my first lady, to my husband in his absence, to all of our deacons and their wives, our ministers and their wives, everyone, our mothers, our ministers of music, everyone in their respective places. We do have some reminder announcements. December 9th is our annual fellowship dinner. Time of the dinner is at 7 p.m. Please be prompt. This year there is no charge for the fellowship dinner. We want you to come and enjoy and just fellowship. The attire is business attire. Jeans are allowed with blazers. So just come out and have a good time. Invite somebody. There is going to be live entertainment. Of course, you know we have a photographer. And let us not forget the meal that the kitchen staff is preparing. It's going to be really, really nice this year. There's going to be giveaways and drawings, raffles, a little bit of everything, and also a fashion show featuring our youth here at our local church. So prepare yourselves again. That date is December 9th. Let us not forget, December 25th is our Christmas service. This is on a Sunday, and we will be having a service. Also, December 31st is our New Year's Eve service. Special ministries, all auxiliaries, please prepare yourselves to minister that night. And January 1st is our New Year's Day service, which also falls on a Sunday. And let us not forget that that is Sacrificial Sunday. Attention, just a reminder to all ministers and their wives, there is a brief meeting immediately after service, as well as deacons. There is a meeting for you as well. You've heard the announcements. Please govern yourselves accordingly.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Linda. Amen. Come on, let's give God a praise. Come on, give God a worship. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. 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 How many are ready for the word of God? You ready for the word of God? Amen. How many believe that God has a word for our lives? Oh, man, this is the most important time of the service. I really believe that God called us together. And when he called us together, God gave us a man of God. Amen. That would preach his word and teach us the word of God so we can go out, amen, and do everything Christ told us to do. Let the church say amen. Amen. The word of God come to build us up. It come to encourage us. Amen. It comes to give us insight, give us knowledge. That's what the word of God does. Amen. Amen. So, and, you know, with all your heart and your mind, come on, let's pay close attention, amen, as the man of God getting ready to come forth to bring the word of God, amen. Anybody excited about the word? I'm excited about the word, man, amen. Amen, our bishop, he's in the building. I know he's in the building, so, amen. Y'all just give God some praise. I'm stalling a little bit. But how many know our God is good, amen? Amen. Amen, our God is awesome. I heard that women's service was awesome this past. I heard it was a great women's service, amen. Amen. I missed this Sunday. Amen. That's why I was praising God the way I was doing. Thanks to God. I was trying to make up. I was trying to make up for Sunday. Can't take a fresh man. But I thank be to God, man. I'm like David. Boy, I say, I'm like David. Say, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord, man. Because one thing I do know, man, I know when I get in the house of the Lord, I know God going to refresh me. I know God going to give me a word for my situation. I know that God is, he's going to strengthen me in my walk. And he's going to give me some instructions, amen, about tomorrow. How many need instruction for tomorrow? You need instruction for tomorrow? Man, I need some instruction, boy. Boy, it's a lot of stuff going on. As I was saying earlier, I mean, just before our bishop come up, we're living in a time now, we're living in the last days, saints of God. And it's no coincidence that you feel that, you can feel that, that spirit, the spirit of depression, oppression, hatred, non-tolerance. That spirit right now is so prevalent in the last days. You know, because the scripture told us, Jesus said that because of sin shall abound in the last days, he said the love of many gonna wax cold. Come on, tell your neighbor, say, man, you got to fight for love. I'm telling you, the enemy trying to steal your love. That's what the enemy is trying to do. As a believer, he's trying to steal your love. So you got to fight, amen. You got to fight for that love, amen, that Christ has imparted in our heart, given to us by the Holy Ghost. Let the church say amen. Here go our bishop. Let's give it up for our man of God. Amen. Our bishop, as he come forth. God bless you, bishop.
Amen. How's everybody? Good. God's good. Amen. Thank God. Thank God for another opportunity to be in the house of worship. I know y'all were going to laugh when y'all hear me. But God still is a good God. Deacon Banks had already shook off. Amen. God's good. Amen. I've been doing talking all day. I said, Lord, how am I going to preach tonight? I don't know, but God's good, amen? All right. It's good for us to come in and assemble ourselves together, amen, and I hope and I trust that, especially you that are members here at the Bible Church of God, I pray and I hope that you are really growing in knowledge and you understand your purpose of coming to church, coming to the house of God. It's just not for the purpose of coming to church because it's my duty. It's that I understand now I come to the house of God so I can accumulate wisdom from God. The greatest thing you can have as a believer, listen to me when I say this, the greatest thing you can have as a believer is God's perspective on how to do things in life. Okay. Now I'm going to say that again. What I just said then is worth the admission of you coming to church tonight. The greatest thing you can have in life as a believer is God's perspectives on how to do things. And what I mean when I say that is this. Now, you just won't automatically, because you're saved, you won't automatically have God's perspectives. You have to seek after it. You gotta hear good, listen to what I'm gonna say, biblical preaching. That has to be your desire. To hear good biblical preaching. That has to be your passion. You want to hear good biblical preaching. And you don't want to hear preaching for the sake of the message is making me feel good. You want to hear good biblical preaching so it can teach me God's perspectives. And that simply means this. In life, as a believer, this most time when you see Jesus teaching in the scripture, this the message that Jesus was teaching. He taught this message, and when he was sent down on the mountain, and he taught, "Blessed is the poor in spirit, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted." He said, "Blessed are they which are persecuted for." He was teaching about having perspectives as a believer. No? Amen. You got to have perspectives as a believer. If you're ever going to get blessed, watch me. Listen, I'm going to say. If you're ever going to get blessed, if you're ever going to walk in God's increase, believe me, the only way that you're going to walk in God's increase is that you have God perspectives. And you can't follow those perspectives unless you have them. And I talk to people, and people have been in church all their lives. And I talk to them sometimes, and it so tears my heart up because they don't have God perspectives. You know, they can quote the little scripture that you done heard all your life. They can quote the, because you know they've been in somebody's church. But in situations in life, they feel like they don't need to have God perspectives. What they do is say, well, you know, they say, well, you have faith in God, but Pastor Bishop Bank, you got to have common sense. I was talking to a lady today, but you got to have common sense. Your greatest commodity, your greatest virtue as a believer to have in your life is, I'm saying it again, you got to have God perspectives. You know, and I won't be before you long. Just want to do it by the way of instruction. And some people, we come to church, and that goes for me too. But you know one thing I won't ever neglect? I don't care what I'm dealing with, what I'm going through. I never, never neglect God perspectives. I don't care what it is you deal with. You want to know God's way of doing things. Okay? As a believer. And don't you know that's what the Bible is for? That's what the Bible is for. As a believer. Let me say something to you. Let me do my scripture text for tonight. Do Psalms, first chapter. Psalms, first chapter.
Hallelujah.
Amen. So y'all know I came to church in the right time because I couldn't do praise and worship. Psalms, first chapter. Let me ask you a question. Watch what I'm about to say. How many of you in here love God? Amen. Let me see your hand. You can say you love God. Okay, now put it down. Now, let me watch this. Listen to my next question. How many of you in here love God's laws? Oh, and too many hands going up. Oh, okay. There was no slick one there. Yeah, straight. How many of you love God? Okay, how many of you love God's laws? I still ain't got but a few of y'all hands going up. How you going to love God without loving his laws? You know, that's the problem with people. Come on, feel me in this. Feel me right here. You ever talk to people, church people, and then they say they love God? They love God. But when you start talking to them about God, they don't know none of his laws. How are you going to say you love God and you don't love his laws? How are you going to say you love God and you don't love? I'm going to ask you a question. You love God? One more time, let me see. You love God? You don't love God? What's wrong with you? Them little girls, they showed out Sunday, didn't they? That's good service, really good service. How are you gonna say that you love God? And then I ask the next question, do you love God's laws? If you don't love God's laws, then you don't love God. I know, because many people, it really is. And I'm finding myself talking to a lot of, and I'm finding people now that I didn't even know that they were a believer. Now, you know, I'm finding out that they say that they've been Christian all their lives, and I'm sitting out having these conversations with them, and it broke my heart. And I'm just on the day. It broke my heart for to have these people that say they've been in church all their lives. All their lives. They told me the background they come from. And then I'm sitting down talking about a simple scripture. And you know they didn't have no idea on what the scripture meant. And it breaks my heart. People don't listen at what. You know, and I think it's a lot of the fault, let me put the blame where it's supposed to be at, a lot of the fault is because of the pulpit. Pastors don't preach. They just be up and entertain to try to make people holler. Listen, you ain't got, never holler no more when I preach. Don't, you know, just sit there and put a clothespin on your mouth. As long as you accumulate information, you need to understand who you are as a son, as a daughter of God. You need to understand that. If you don't understand who you are, there is no way you can operate in it. And so many people, you know, so many believers, you never stop learning. You never stop learning. God, how you ever going to get to the epic of God? How you ever going to reach that level of you know everything God wants you to know? And so many times people, that what we've done, we've shut the knowledge of God down and said, well, I'm going to go for what I know. I'm going to just, you know, this is what I know. And my heart is so really go out for people. And you, and I'm pastoring you. I'm pastoring you, and it's my job to pastor and preach God's word to you. If you sit up in here, listen at me. Listen. You sit up in here, and you come to church. You don't have no passion about instructions from the Word of God. Look, you need God's instructions on how to raise your children. You let the world teach us. It's sad. You let the world teach you how to raise your children. Then you want to do your own thing. See, and sometimes I just try to leave y'all alone, because I know sometimes your head going to get hard to just flow. Sometimes I see and don't see, because I know you know better. You just want to do what you want to do anyway. Amen. Say amen. And you know, okay, amen. All right. So sometimes I see and I don't see, because I know we just preached that, or you just heard it from the women's ministry, or you just heard it from the youth ministry, or you just heard the word of God, and then you just chose not to pay attention and put it to work. And I just told them this. What good does it do you to sit in church and hear what God says and you never try to do what it says? What good does that do you? What good? What good for you to sit in church and you hear what God says, and then you get a good understanding of what God said. I'm trying to make the vision plain. I'm trying to make this vision plain so him that or her that hear it, that read it, They'll know how to run. Look, why reading it if you ain't gonna walk it? Why? I mean, you're not gonna live the life out. I told somebody, it renders you a vain person. If you sit in church and you hear the word of God being preached, and you know for a fact that that's the truth, and you sit in church and you don't get passionate enough to hear what God is saying and apply those things to your life, it profit you nothing to hear it. It profit you nothing to hear it. there is a place in God, a peace in God. There is a place where God reveals himself. Listen at this now. Listen at what I'm going to tell you. There is a place where God reveals himself to human beings. There is a place, and the only way you can get to this place is by following his instructions. And don't sit up here and say, because I'm a believer and I'm saved. Now, when you get saved and accept Jesus, now your spiritual ears are open. Now your spiritual understanding is open. Now you have the ability to discern God. An unsaved person do not have the ability to discern God. God don't talk to unsaved people. Now, I know it's going to be hard for you to grasp that, but just find it in the text where you do. Find it in your Bible. And that's relationship, sin in our life. If we have not did the thing that allow God to cover sin in our life, then God has no communication with us. He has no communication with us. If the blood of Jesus hadn't covered us from our sin, if we haven't been forgiven, we are sinners. God do not have communication with sinners. I don't know, see? I ain't get a bunch of amen. Because saints, you know, and again, I'm going to put a lot of the fault in reason why ignorance is in believers' life, because it's not taught scripturally, informatively from the pulpit. From the pulpit. And it's sad to me, you know, and I'm telling you, my heart broke so much. It's sad to me, and I said, God, thank you for the understanding that I have. You know, I thank you for it. I was talking to my daughter today. I said, man, I really do thank God for the insight. I said, I thank God for how he revealed himself through the scripture, through the word of God. I thank God. And I told her, I said, baby, that's what I want for you. And I'm telling you this. I said, baby, it don't matter what you do. It don't matter how gifted you are. I said, let me tell you something. Can't nothing take the place of you as a believer now spending time with God alone. I said, if you don't remember nothing that daddy told you, I said, you need to get this. If the increase of God is ever going to overflow in your life, you cannot avoid spending time with God, talking to him. I'm not trying to make this sound like a deep thing. This ain't no deep thing, people. When I say spending time with God, when you get saved, all your sins are forgiven. Watch me now. Once you get saved, your sins are remitted. What separates you from God? Your sin. What Jesus died for? Your sins. So the minute your sins are covered, now you have the ability to talk with God. Your communication is open. You can talk to God. Every one of us. Every one of us can talk to God. Because I'm a pastor, I have no advantage over you. You can talk to God. I have a specific role that I have to play in the church. I have to carry out. But I have no advantage over you. And so it's very important that we understand and get this information. You know, you're going to sit up in church. Listen at me. You're going to sit up in church. And you're going to let any and everything get your attention. Yeah, I mean, any and everything get your attention. When you come to the house of God, what did I just say? When you come to whose house? Okay. When you come to whose house? House of who? God. God is in charge of this house. How do you know if the information of God is being passed over this house? You got your Bible. Don't say it because Bishop said it. No, the scripture said it. The scripture said it. If Bishop said it and the scripture didn't say it, then it ain't right. The scripture says it. So now you study the scripture and find out how you got to operate as a man of God, as a woman of God. Find out. Get God precepts. Find out. Listen at me. And I know none of us in here is perfect, and that's not an excuse for us to sin. We're just not perfect. Are you hearing me? We're not perfect. None of us is perfect. And you know what God promised us? God said, I'll never hold back wisdom from you if you ask me for it. What? I'll never hold wisdom back from you if you ask me for it. I never hold wisdom back from you if you ask me for it. I won't hold it back from you if you what? Now, what wisdom mean? That's James 1 and what? 5. So I never hold my way of living life back from you if you ask me. So how do you ask God? Now, you can't ask God if your sins hadn't been remitted. What? He don't talk to you. He don't talk to people that are not saved. No, I'm trying to say this so slow that, like, you know how you people, you know how you cook and you put stuff in that called a pressure cooker? Yeah, slow cook it. That's what I'm trying to do tonight, slow cooking. The reason why a lot of you missing out blessings on your life, because you won't want to follow God's instructions. You thinking, listen at me, you thinking because a man tell you that that's not God. Let me ask you, you think God going to send an angel down to tell you? How you going to get the information? That's who God's going to use. He going to use little imperfect people like me. He going to put a car. But it ain't my wisdom. It ain't my wisdom. You know, I so appreciate the grace of God on my life. I go out in a panic when I think about how much God has revealed and shown to me. Oh, crazy boy from Pahokee to Muck. And I just get wild. I know it's God's grace. Are you hearing me? It's God. Listen, it's God's ways that's gonna cause you to prosper. When people giving you God's ways, stop sitting there fighting against God's ways. God's ways is gonna cause you to prosper. It's gonna cause, as a mama, you want God's ways. You want to know, okay, God, how should I handle this daughter? How should I raise this boy? Because evidently, you ain't doing it right with your own way or with Oprah them way, with the world way. It works. God ways, God, ask you a question. You believe that God way is the best way? That's about a third of the church. Wait, for real, you believe God's way is the best way? You think God will tell you to do something that you really don't want to do? The next, I said, do you think God will tell you to do something that you really don't want to do? Yeah. Most time, he going to tell you to do something that you really don't. Because you want to do how you feel of what you done grew up in. And God tell us strictly, watch God's law. He said, love people that hurt you. He said, love people that talk about you. He said, love your enemies. And God tells us, he said, matter of fact, he said, do good to them that do bad to you. What? Do you rejoice in that information? I do. I rejoice in that information because I really believe if I do it God's way, it's going to benefit me. I believe if I do it God's way, I believe it's working for my good. Even though my flesh want to act another way, my flesh want to do something else, My flesh wanna act accordingly, but you know, and it don't wanna really do what God wanted to do. That's why you gotta live as a man of God, as a woman of God. You gotta live by faith. What's faith? What's faith? Simply trusting in what God said. Doing the thing the way God said do it. Don't run from God's instruction. Many people have ran from God's instruction, and that's why they're in trouble. That's why they're in trouble, because we ran from God's instruction. All right, let me do Psalms 1. What time do we have? Okay. Psalms 1. Psalms 1 and 1. All right. Psalms 1 and 1. She's putting it up on the screen. I'm going to read it from a different translation, okay? It says, Oh, the joys of those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or stand around with sinners, or join in with mockers. Verse 1. Then number 2 says, but they delight in the law of God. Do you not know that you got some people that are saved, they don't delight in God's law? I'm telling you, and I know I got some in my church. I got some of y'all in here. I got some of y'all in here. That's why God allowed me to preach you tonight. And I know you do love God. I know you do love God with your senses. And you know that God gave his son to die for you. I know that part. But the way that you grow in God's grace is that you grow in God's knowledge. The way that you grow in God's love is that you grow in God's knowledge. And now it says, but his or her delight is in God's laws. Let me tell you why God fell off his rocker for David. And you know what David did. Many of you read the story. You know, David took the man's wife. He took Uriah's wife. Took it. David, he then, not only did he take the man's wife, he had the man killed. The Bible called David a murderer. Okay? And you can read about the story in there. You can read about it. But you know you're reading the New Testament. You know what God said in the book of Acts? God said David was a man after my own heart. You know who wrote this song? The adulterer and the murderer. You know, every verse, listen at this knowledge. Listen at me. The biggest book in the Bible is Psalms. David wrote the biggest book in the Bible, the adulterer, the murderer. And you know, in every verse, check this out, in every verse in Psalms, every verse, read it for yourself, every verse in Psalms, it has the word precept, laws, judgments. Every verse, not one verse in Psalms that does not have instruction, God's laws. And David said, I delight in the law of God. Psalm 119:9. Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? Therefore, by taking heed to God's word, or to the law of God, or to God's precepts, or to God's judgment, or to God's discretions. They mean the same thing. And every verse in 150 chapters in the book of Psalms, that's what David alluded to. When I first heard it, I tried it. I said, you got to be kidding me. And I just started reading the Psalms. And I had a Bible where I read the Psalm, and every time I got to it, I underlined it. There it is. I got several million televisions. I said, there it is. Oops, there it is. So he says, I delight in what? What my delight is in? Law of God. What you delight in? Law of God. So sometimes we get so hung up on people, and get so hung up on how we feel. But I hope you fall in love with God's law. God's perspectives. This is why God was so head over, and that's why he bragged about David, and he talked about David. He says, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? Therefore, by taking heed thereto according to thy word. And then the next verse said, David said, Psalm 119 and 9, the 10th verse said, and David said, with my whole heart have I sought after thy law. What? The adulterer, the murderer. And you know what God did? David, and God bragged on David, but you know God didn't allow David to build his house? There's always consequences for sin. Amen. But God didn't never say, even though God didn't allow him to build a house, God come right back behind him and say, David was a man after my own heart. He said, but you can't build my house because your hand got blood on it. But he said, I'm going to bless you anyhow. I'm going to let you have a boy, and your son going to be in your house. God got grace, but David had to give an account for his sin. Look, you got to love God's law. You can't be sitting out here fighting against God. You think you're going to win? I'm be scared for people. They just want to fight against God. I don't care what y'all say. It ain't no y'all. It's God. You decide that you're going to fight against God's law? Let me tell you something. If you don't think this church preaching God's laws, no, we ain't perfect. But if you don't think we're preaching God's law, you need to go find your place where you think they're preaching God's laws so you can respect that. That's all that matters. It don't matter about your little fleshly antics. God already knew you were going to do what you did before you did it. He already knew what we were going to do before we did it. But yet and still, he covered up with his grace and saved us. He still saved us. He already knew how crazy we were, but he still saved us because we asked him to save us. And he already knew everything about you. Everything. He knew what you're going to do in 10 years. But he still imparted grace on you. And he still loves you right where you are. He know we're going to make crazy decisions 10 years from now. I know that's none of our plans, I hope. But his delight is in what? The law of the Lord. I mean, what do you love more than God's laws? You know, what do you love more than God's ways? Your own way? You know, a man or a woman that don't seek God's way, they don't love God's way. Because you can't make a statement like this, you know, simply because a man or woman seek God's way that they perfect. No. No. Hey, look what he said. I delight in the law of God. Look what the murderer said. What did he delight in? Knowing the way God said do things. The man know when he broke God's law, he know God didn't like it. He knew it because he knew God's laws. But did his heart turn away from God's laws? No. And when God came and told the prophet Samuel, Nathan. Samuel had died. His son Nathan. You know what God always do? Anytime a man, listen at me. Anytime a man or a woman, anytime they love God laws, God will make sure you have a man of God in your life to speak a word in your life. That's why the enemy so comes against men of God and the preach word. That's why he's so coming, because if he gets you offended at the person, you ain't going to hear God's word. Doesn't that make sense? So if I was the devil, and the devil ain't stupid. So if I was the devil, I always make you have a problem with the man of God. Always try to bring up some confusion. So here it is, Nathan was a man of God. Now watch this. Did David love God's laws? What did he say? I delight in what? Laws of God. God laws, the way God tells us to do things. Said, in his law, does he do what? The adulterer and the murderer. See, we have so limited concept about the things of God till we just go crazy around church. Judge people, take them off where they supposed God have them at, judge folk, and look at them crazy, and God will use the same person that messed up to bless you. But there we are, we mad at them. Because they done did something out of God's laws. You mad at them. So God can't use Deacon Bennett. Not for you. Just using something. Because Deacon Bennett, he done left his wife. So God can't use him no more. You see the concept we have as a church? God ain't never put no confidence in man's ability to live for him. And God will never put no confidence in you and me to live and carry out his righteous laws. That's why we got to praise Jesus so much. Because he carried out the law. What we could not do in our flesh, Christ Jesus came in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin, that's H out of Roman. Condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us. Not because we right, because what he did was righteous. I didn't get to this scripture. I got to quit at 9:30. But I didn't get to this scripture. The Bible says in Romans 8:8-7. Keep it right there. You ain't got to flip it. 8:8. For they that are in the flesh cannot please God. What is that? 8:6, 7:8 or something? For they that are in the flesh cannot do what? Please God. Okay. Let me say it again. For they that are in the flesh cannot. This is not talking about unsaved people. It's talking about saved people that don't love God's laws. Hey, when you don't love God's laws, you can't help but to be a carnal-minded Christian. When you don't love God's laws, you ain't got nothing but a flesh mind. You gonna try to live by how you feel. You're going to try to live by how you think. You're going to live by, well, you know how it's new. You're going to try to live by those concepts. So that's what, so those that are in the flesh cannot please God. What did that verse say? So those that in their own way of thinking, doing what I want to do, not listening to the word of God, not listening to the laws of God, cannot please God. I don't know how you thought about that, but that's both volume to me. Even if I wanted to please God, if I don't listen to his laws, I can't please him. Because if I don't listen to his laws, that means I'm fleshly minded. If I don't listen to his laws, that means I'm going to live by how I feel. I'm going to live by what I think. And every time a man, a woman, a man live like that, you always miss God. You don't miss him sometimes. You always miss God. And it doesn't matter because you saved. That's what David's just saying. That's what David teaching us. It don't matter because you saved. People think, we think because we saved, we just get away with anything. We don't. Salvation will give you a liberty to not love God's law. Because I'm saved, and you just feel like I do what I feel. You know, the blood cover me. And this is a whole nother different perspective. And in his law, does he do what? David said, I meditate in God's law when? Come on. Every believer in here. He said, David was nothing but a believer. He just had a position as a king. And this man loved it, God. And God said that he loved it, him. But he made sinful and fleshly decision choices. He made them. And did he pay for them? One time we're going to go through that lesson. We're going to see how he paid. So we think you make them fleshly and carnal decision, and you think, oh, you know, the grace of God cover me. You got to pay for them consequences. No. You have to pay for them. And I ain't come here to try to preach that. I mean, you got to say it because it's truth. And so sometimes you got a lot of people that's just naive about it. So that's why they don't love God's laws. When people tell you God's law, let people help you. When I be telling you certain things in church, I'm not telling you because I'm trying to help you. My main concern about you is that you know God better. You ain't got to like me. I don't care. But if you can know God better, man, if I can get you to just know God better, you ain't got to even think about me. Just know God better. Third verse. And he shall be like a tree. Watch this. He or she gonna be like a tree planted where? God, dog. You show me some stable people, I'll show you men and women that love God's law. Show me some people that look like they got it all together. I'll show you some people that love God's law. Show me some stable people. And to my saved people, I'll show you people that love God's law. For he shall be like a tree. She shall be like a tree planted by what? Rivers of water. That bring forth its fruit in its seasons. Okay? And its leaf also shall not wither. And whatsoever they do, turn to the neighbor and say, don't hate the player. Have you ever seen somebody that got grace in their life and you kind of want a little piece of it? I'm going to talk on this side of it. I said, have you ever seen people in life, they got grace in their life and you want a little piece of it? I've seen it. That's what blessed me. That's what caused me to go after things. I see where God blessing that man or blessing that woman. And I get in their life and I find out what they do, how they act, how they living it out. You can't get what's on people's life if you don't understand how they got there. Many people think it for me, they think about it all in the pulpit. Shoot. Oh. shall bring forth his fruit in the season. His leaf also shall not wither. And whatsoever they do, they'll do what? Prosper. Haters can hate you, but you'll prosper. I was telling my wife or somebody, I said, I don't know who I shared this with, somebody in our church family. I said, listen, it's not getting up here talking about people got to pay duty, you got to do this, do this, do that. Hey, sometimes I don't even want y'all to say stuff like that. You just tell people, whenever you give to God, you tithe, you honor God. Amen. You honor God with your giving. When you don't tithe, you dishonor God. What you want me to say? Yeah, you're in a curse? No, I ain't even talking about no curse. Because y'all think blessing is, I get me a big house, I get me a big car. You think that's blessing. Do you not know wicked people got big houses and big cars? And no peace and no substance. But when you want to be so, till when God bless you with your house, you got peace going in. And your body ain't tore all up. And you can go to sleep at night. And you ain't wearing your fool head off about things. For the blessing of the Lord is not sorrowful. And many people try to fake like they bless it. And they don't know where the next income going to go for somebody to come pick it up. And so, so when you start operating the blessing of God, you ain't gotta, even though being blessed is gonna be a testing of your faith. Your faith go be tested. But even if they do turn my lights off, or even if I lost the house, I bet you, if I went through that, I bet you I learned something from that. I bet you the next one I get, I won't lose it. Because I'm gonna take this knowledge that I learned from that, I'm taking over here in the other season of my life. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I might did do some stupidness over here. Things that I made bad choices. But I bet you I ain't leaving this place until I learn from it. I bet you I'm going to learn from it. I bet you when God give me the grace to move on, I bet you I ain't gonna walk in no ignorant grace. My grace going to have some knowledge behind it. But if you don't love God's laws, you're going to be ignorant anyway. I know you think you're smart because you got a good job and DDs. Your BA degree in. And you're slicker than all the other folk around you. But if you don't love God's laws, if you don't love the way God does things, I'm saying it to you again, you don't love God. You may have a feeling for God, but you don't love him. Here it is again. I love God's laws because I believe. Watch this. Somebody said, why you love God's laws? I love God's laws because I believe whatever God says is going to work out for my good. I might not like doing it, but I know it's going to work out for my good. When you do God's laws, God, let me tell you this. The reason why God did not leave David like he left Saul. That's good there. You got to get that for your information. David did bad, worse things than Saul did. You know, when you love God's laws, your haters can't kill you. Only thing is when you don't love God's laws and you decide that you're going to do things the way you want to do or you go into it. Let's finish the psalm. It's the psalm is going to tell you. Let's do the fourth verse. What time is it? I'm cutting off 9:30. Okay, I got 10 minutes. The ungodly are not what? So who the ungodly talking about? Sinners? No. People that don't love God's laws. They call us ungodly people. You're ungodly if you don't love the law of God. How you going to be saved and ungodly? Because you don't love God's laws. I know I ain't perfect, and I know I ain't all that. But let me tell y'all something. Y'all ain't gonna sit around me that ain't gonna hold you to a certain accountability. Come on, we got to hold one another. And when it's time to repent, we need to repent. That go for all of us. First of thought, right here first. That's what God's law says. I ain't got time to get in that because I kill my 10 minutes up. Ungodly are not so, but are like the what? Shaft with the wind do what? Drive away. Other words, your life is going to be like a cold winter. A shaft which the wind drives away, parched all up. So you know when a strong wind comes with shaft, it's just, you don't know where your life at. Blow all over the place. No stability. You ain't like a tree. You a shaft. So when the next storm come in, they're telling where we going to find you. Oh, you might be here with your body on Sunday, but your life. Your life might be blowing everywhere. There is so much stability when men and women of God decide that they're going to follow the laws of God. You got to love God's law. I might not be perfect in it, but I know that's God's law. I knew I shouldn't have did that. I know I shouldn't have walked out of there. I know that's God's law, and I respect that. When it comes down to God's law, zip it. But you got so many people that don't love God's law, they start talking against God. You think you're going to win when you fight against God? You know, Gamaliel told them people that want to whoop the apostle for preaching Jesus. Gamaliel said, okay, now y'all supposed to be some wise men. He said, now, if this work that they doing be of God, y'all can't overthrow it. I know you got all the power, but you ain't got power over God. You know, you got some people that think they can win against God. I don't care what you say. This one, okay, well, go at it, chief. Go at it, dog. Bro. Fifth verse. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the right. I'm talking about the judgment. In other words, you did nothing in your life to glorify God. That's not talking about whether you're going to heaven or hell. In other words, as an ungodly person, your life was never edifying for the kingdom of God. Isn't that sad? Don't sit here and try to justify yourself. If you're talking about, well, I done did some people some good. You got sinners that done took care of people. You got sinners that done fed people. What have your life been for the kingdom of God? What have you done to edify the kingdom? I'm talking about the kingdom. You say, well, because I've been to church. I come to church every Sunday. What they got to do with building the kingdom? You come to church because the church don't need you. You need it. And so, because people do a couple of good deeds, they think that they glorified the kingdom. Sinners do that. You got a cult, people that in a cult, they send food to Africa and feed poor people. Good deeds. So that's what they're saying. Nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. Move it. Sixth verse. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous. Well, who is God calling righteous? when that little guy lost. You know, people that ain't following God laws, the psalm call them a sinner. I know we're in the New Testament. We understand the New Covenant. I try to make you understand that so you won't walk in fear. So you won't walk in fear of losing your salvation. For God has not given you the spirit of what? Fear. That's Psalms, that's Timothy 1 and 7. For God has not given you the spirit of fear. You ain't got to walk around here like, oh, I'm going to go to hell. Oh. No, the blood, teaching of the blood, will teach you security in Jesus. So God haven't given you the spirit of fear or intimidation, but he'll give you the spirit of love, power, and a sound mind. I'm sound because I know I'm going to heaven. I'm sound. I ain't got to work for salvation. I'm sound that my performance don't get me closer to God. I had a preach right there, but I can't preach it like I want. People think their performance get them close to God. Because you come to church more than other people, you think you're closer to God than they are. Because you don't cuss, you think you're closer to God than they are. Because you don't do this, I ain't never did that. I ain't never drunk. But you've been the biggest hell raiser in the world. You should have drunk. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall, perish. The way of the ungodly shall what? Perish. And not talking about perishing in hell. It's talking about that you would never fulfill, you would never walk in the blessing of the Lord that the Lord has equipped for you to walk in. Seventh verse. Keep up my time. Sixth verse. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall do what? Perish. You know. And that's probably, and that's why for me, for myself, just as a, I know it's gotta be the Spirit of God. You know, I know it's gotta be the Spirit of God that caused me to have a passion because I want people to know God's precepts. Don't be stupid. If you decided you made that choice, all right, don't try to sit around there and act like you don't know God's precepts. Now know this, because you made the choice, know that there are consequences coming with the choice that you make. You know what I mean? I'm done. But I had an opportunity today, you know, just devotion time, and I kind of went over the story of Jonah. I hadn't read that story in a long time. You know. So, you know, you look in the lesson. Now, one day I might have a chance to preach it to you. Look in the lesson, and you find out that Jonah was a Jew boy, that God had gave him a message to go preach to a Gentile nation. I mean, God loves everybody. But the reason why Jonah didn't want to preach to him, because Jonah was prejudiced. Jonah wanted God to kill them people. Here you got a prophet of God, a man of God, a man that wrote a book in the inspired word of God. Prejudice. And so I'm sitting there reading it. So God done told Jonah to go preach to the Nineveh. You know that joker didn't do it. That joker went and caught him. That joker went and bought him a ticket. And he went opposite of where God told him to go. I hope I ain't got no Jonahs in here and Jonah success. He go totally opposite of where God told him to do. And you know what God did? Check this out. This is my lesson. I'm done. You know, this is what God did. The text says, God, and you read it, next time you read this, it says, when he was going opposite of where God told him to go, God, it said God spoke to the well. God spoke to a well. And I got a disobedient child out here. I need you to go out here and open your mouth up. The well obeyed him. And that well knew the exact time they were going to throw Jonah overboard. Jonah found himself in the belly of a well. And I can't do it justice now for all that I can't obtain out of the lesson. But in the belly of the well, in the belly of the well, watch, Jonah prayed. Where did he pray from? The belly of a well. He prayed from the belly of a well, and God heard his prayer. And then God spoke to the well again. He said, go and vomit Jonah up. And you know what the well did? The well turned around, went back towards where God had told Jonah to go preach to. Spit that boy up on shore. And the text says, Jonah, you know, what it would have took him a long time to do. The text said that Jonah went and preached to the city of Nineveh in one day. That's it. And look, my last thing, and I'm done. I can't do this justice like I wanted, but the last thing. You know what got my attention back? I kind of read that God spoke to the well. And so, now Jonah, even though Jonah was still mad, Jonah was mad because God was going to deliver them people. He was mad at God. So what God did, so God sent Jonah on the outside of the city. And so Jonah was out there chilling on the outside of the city. And it was so hot out there. Tell Jonah, let me picture Jonah like I want to picture him, all right? You picture him how you want to picture him. I'm preaching this. I picture Jonah as a bald head man like mine. Out in the midst of that hot heat. And that heat was bearing down on his head. And he looked at the guy and said, you don't care if I die. He don't care for 100,000 people. It's 120,000 people he don't care about. They gonna die. But he's done up there because he got a little heat wave. He's taking the God. You don't care if I die. And you know what God did? God caused a flower bush, a guard, to come up over his head to shield him off for the sun. Boy, God got a sense of humor in it. And I'm sitting there listening to the story. He caused a guard to come up over his head. And Jonah, and so when that thing come up with Jonah's head, he said, wow. He chilling out there. Just like the text says, you go back and read it, that God spoke to the well. Well, God caused the God to grow. Then the text says, it tickled me when I read it. God spoke to a worm. From a well to a worm. Told a worm to go eat the flower that was covering Jonah's head. And the worm did just what God said do. Jonah got mad again. From a well to a worm. And the worm ate off the God. Jonah got mad again. And God started ministering to Jonah. It says, now, you mad at the God that was over your head because it was shielding you from the sun. How much more than the wrath of God is over these people's lives and you don't care nothing about them. God began to minister to him in the midst of that. And it's saying, read Jonah, it's an exciting book. I just want to share that with y'all because it was blessing me so much. Rest on your feet. I'm so done. God bless you. Amen. Go to shake somebody's hand and encourage them. Say, hey, sister, brother, let's love God's laws more than we love our own opinions. Let's love his precepts. Love his viewpoints. In Jesus' name, I'm praying for you that you would desire and be passionate about the laws of God. Amen. Give him a praise offering. Amen. Bless Jesus' name. Slip our hands towards heaven. We give you praises, Jesus. Give him glory now. Give him praise for his word. Bless your name, Lord God. Hallelujah. Thank you for your mercy over our lives. Thank you for your grace, Lord God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Amen. Every thankful heart, just begin to give God thanks for his protection over your life. You know you shouldn't have been where you are, but God watched over you. He protected you. He covered your life. Bless your name, Lord God. We praise you, Lord God. Thank you now, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And let your word penetrate our hearts and penetrate our lives. Please help us to love one another and not to judge one another. Help us to bless one another and to cover one another. But help us to be more so in love with your laws and your words. We bless you now, Jesus. We give you thanks now. Thank you for covering our families. Thank you for making ways for us. We thank you for the doors that you've already opened for us. Thank you for the unseen doors. Thank you for the doors that you shut in our face. Thank you for directions. We give you praise. Jesus' name. Everybody say amen. Give him a good praise one more time. Bless the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Anybody need prayer? Let's pray for you. We'll pray for you if you're here. Amen. So much for being out of service tonight. It's your benefit. We're praying for you. Keep us in your prayers, all right? And take heed to what God's word is saying. You might not understand how you're going to get there, but you just love God's laws. And God will empower you to get where he wants you to go. And it's not going to be by your own strength. It's going to be by his strength. Just love God's laws. Love God's laws more than anything. And every now and then, you got to throw your hands up and say, God, your way is right. My way is wrong. Teach me your laws. Amen. Thank God for you. God bless you. All right. I'm done. That's it. Thank God for my wife, Sister Banks. God bless you. God bless you. Slip our hands towards heaven. I know I got meetings after service. I want to see the deacons first, please. Y'all come fast as y'all can. I want to see the deacon first. Then I want to see the young peoples, okay? As quick as you can, it won't be long. Yeah. Let's do our benediction. Come and let's announce the grace of God. Ready? Let's declare it. Now unto him, which is able to keep us from falling, to present us faultless from the presence of his glory, the exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Redeemers of God say, amen. Shake somebody's hand, tell them the love of God bless you.